It is indeed good to be together today. Let's give thanks to God just for that privilege. Heavenly Father, we are indeed grateful for this blessing today to gather with our loved ones in this family. We're thankful, Father, that we have been blessed to avoid this illness. We're very mindful, though, of those who are still at risk and unable to gather with us today. We know, Father, that we long to be together, and they would be as well. But we are now especially grateful to be your children. The blessings of being gathered as this church. So again, together, consider your precious word. To celebrate all that you have done to save us, to guide us, to train us up in your will. And through this study, we pray, Father, that we're all the more zealous to live according to your will. We seek today to give you our best worship in spirit and in truth. We pray that all that we do glorifies you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, there were six Sundays we weren't here, so having just recently started to consider the Proverbs, we kind of got to get back in gear again this morning. Let's start just really, really basic. What are the Proverbs? A collection of wise sayings. Why did Solomon go to trouble to collect all these sayings? Solomon was a rich man. He had everything anybody could ever want. Why would he bother to do this? What did he figure out finally about all those riches? He had a lot of riches, but they did nothing to satisfy his soul. Who was the primary audience to whom this was first intended? His own sons. He didn't want his own sons to make the mistake that he had done, spending much of his life seeking for more and more stuff that did not satisfy the soul. He also didn't want his sons to act like rich king's sons. He wanted them to know how to live a worthwhile, orderly, soul-satisfying life, but not to do so at the expense of everybody else, not to mistreat others. You know, as privileged sons of the king, they probably thought they could pretty much do whatever they want, and they could. Well, he didn't want them to live that way. That's not a worthwhile life. Yes, Jeff? You know, previously when we talked about this, we mentioned a couple of times that his sons need to learn this because typically young people learn from their peers. And that's true. But what does Solomon really not want? He really doesn't want them to learn from his own mistakes, does he? I mean, forget about their friends. They could look at Dad and say, hey, we just do it. Apple didn't fall far from the tree, Dad. So, you know, he doesn't want them to learn from his example either. And so, there are three kinds of learning in the Proverbs. Remember what three kinds of learning? First comes knowledge, then comes understanding, then comes wisdom, in that order. You know, a knowledge is just to know what the word says. Understanding is to know what it means. Wisdom is to know how to apply it. And so, all of that is revealed, how to get that. For those who really desire it. What is the prerequisite of knowledge?
Making mistakes is probably one part that you can set here. I learned this from my own dad. Making mistakes is how you can learn how not to make mistakes.
But even if you make mistakes, you could keep on doing that. You could say, well, hey, I did it once, I did it twice, I lived through that, I can do it again. What's the prerequisite of knowledge by which we would lead a worthwhile, orderly, and soul-satisfying life? Reverence of God.
Reverence of God.
Chapter 1, verse 7 says, beginning of knowledge is fear of the Lord. That word for fear is the reverence kind of fear. That you so revere all that is awesome and holy and pure about all that God has done. You just seek to know God in His purity. You want to emulate the things that He counts as worthy and holy in His sight. It's that kind of reverence. That's what had to change in Solomon's life, isn't it? To stop seeking after more and more horses and more wives and more everything. There had to be a change. He had to, at some time, truly yearn for the things of God. That's the prerequisite of it. You know, it's the basic choice that everybody has to make. To revere God and revile the flesh, or just the opposite, to revere the flesh and revile God. Everybody's making a choice. Some folks think we can negotiate it to some degree. No, not really. Not really. Uh-huh. Yep.
And it's so crazy because you think about our life, we were too in a certain degree. I mean, I was out there, you know. And it's not till you start really getting older that you really start to see what is most important in this life, which is only God. And everything will follow in the places. But when you're young and the world can just take in, I mean, she watches these videos of the young kids and, you know, she wants that lipstick and she wants to talk this way. And, you know,
yeah. You know, I've still got a want list that's probably longer than it should be, but I was really grateful after I reached 50 years old, it got a lot shorter. The want list shortened up a little bit. It's still too long, isn't it? But still too long, and at times it still gets pretty attractive. But something really changed about that time. You decide, hey, there's got to be something more to this, something far better than what I've been doing all these years. And so, first comes knowledge, then comes understanding. How do you move from knowledge to understanding? You got to seek for it. You got to ask it. I mean, you can pick up knowledge pretty much anywhere. It's even how wisdom is presented. She's on every street corner. But any kind of knowledge, there's plenty of sources for it. But how do you get from knowledge to understanding? You've got to seek for it. You've got to ask God for it. He will certainly give it if you ask. Yes, Joe?
Well, I think one of the material things, we have material things that come set in you. Then you go on, then you start going on a different journey. And your battle is spiritual. And sometimes the spiritual...
It always was. We just didn't know it, but... Yeah, you finally get to the point where you can define it.
Then you start realizing that the material thing is really pretty easy to give up. And then you start going on a different spiritual battle, and are you thinking something you can see, and necessarily. You can see it in circumstances, you can see it in different things, but it's that journey that you're talking about, seeking God, humbling yourself, paying more attention to the spiritual than you.
It's interesting the way you said it more than once. When's the battle begin? After you've made the change. Before, there's the world, you want it, I go get it, and that's no battle. You can have all you want to go for. But there's the battle. When you get understanding, you not only know what God says, but this is how He wants me to live. There's the battle. How do you go then from understanding to wisdom? What's the difference between understanding and wisdom? I mean, there are a lot of people that know exactly what God said, and they can tell you what it means. What's yet lacking? The application. You can know what God wants you to do, but there's plenty of people that know that, but then pervert the application. They're going to do their own thing. That's what Solomon's trying to cause his son to avoid. We talked about this earlier. What are the sources of wisdom? Several sources. Solomon's gotten it from ancient writers, even secular writings. He's got it from all kinds of places, even from life itself. But what are the sources of wisdom? God. Godly parents, which is what he's trying to do now that he's older. Godly counselors. Everybody's got an opinion. Everybody in the world's got an opinion. They've got an explanation. How many opinions ought you to listen to? I mean, most of them ought not to be our counselors. And if all else fails, Solomon reasons that you can look to the creation itself. Well, we had considered some of those sources of wisdom previously. Today we're going to start talking about the results of wisdom. Or in other words, there's 15 actions of wisdom. 15 ways that godly wisdom will change your life for the better. You know, some people sort of put themselves out in the world and it's like they're on automatic pilot. Just going to, or like pinball, the ball just bounces from here to here. You know, it doesn't really matter. No, with godly wisdom, you can control that somewhat, and certainly it'll make your life better. We're going to start in Proverbs chapter 6. The first of 15 ways that godly wisdom will change your life. Proverbs 6 and verse 6, a passage very familiar to you, I'm sure. Go to the ant, O sluggard, observe her ways and be wise, which having no chief, officer, or ruler, prepares her food in the summer and gathers her provision in the harvest. How long will you lie down, O sluggard? When will you arise from your sleep? A little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest. Your poverty will come in like a vagabond, and your need like an armed man. Anything wrong with a little rest, a little slumber, a little? No, not at all. But what's the sluggard say? Well, that last minute rest felt good. I think I'll take another hour of rest. And that one felt so good, I think I'll just sleep all day. What's unique about the ant? Is there any little creature that seems less likely to be powerful, to have everything that it would ever need? You know, Solomon reasons that you can even look to the creation to attain wisdom, and you can look at the ant. Created man is much closer to a created ant than we are to our creator, aren't we? I mean, just the fact that we're both created things. We can learn something from their example because they innately know the need to work. And they lay up food. Of course, food is figurative for abundant life. It's said that most ants, and not true of all the species, but kind of on average, most ants can live about 10 days without food. And man, provided we have enough to drink, can live 3 weeks or longer. But the ant isn't sitting around waiting till, oh, it's the ninth day, I better get some food for tomorrow. I mean, they never let themselves get that close. They're always out there working. And so we see that a determined work ethic and a well-ordered routine is beneficial for life. Some things that might seem insignificant to people are very significant to a blessed life. Look over at Proverbs 30, beginning in verse 24. Again, speaking about creation and all the different animals, some of them even the least of things. Proverbs 30, verse 24. I'm sure you'll remember this passage as well. Four things are small on the earth, not just in size-wise, but small in power, seemingly insignificant. but they are exceedingly wise. The ants are not a strong people, but they prepare food in the summer. The Shephanim, a small race of people, very few people, are not mighty people, and yet they make their houses in the rocks. The locusts have no king, and yet all of them go out in ranks. The lizard you may grasp with the hands, yet it's in the king's palace. None of those things you would consider significant, even that group of people called the Shephanim, that not a significant bunch of people, most people hardly would ever think of them. Pardon? Shouldn't
have.
Yeah, I don't know why I said people. It's a little furry badger living in the rocks. But you know, you wouldn't expect anything big or significant about any of those things. But what do those four created things have in common? Reminds me of the book of the Revelation. The Revelation is about overcomers. What are those four little creatures? All of them are overcomers, aren't they? You wouldn't expect they were mighty to do anything. But we can gather much wisdom from those self-motivated, self-controlled, persistent creatures who use their innate, not even their strength, but their innate fortitude to overcome their weaknesses. And they prosper greatly despite the great odds against them. Any of us who live down in Texas know how hard it is to get rid of some fire ants. I mean, they can overcome a lot of things. Yes, Lyle? Still, they have to have the innate fortitude to get up and do something, don't they? Doesn't it matter if you're equipped to be the leader or the follower or the ruler or the, whatever. You just got to get up and do something. And that's the point of this. This is about the actions of the wise. Look at Proverbs 8 and verse 33. Proverbs 8 and verse 33. Proverbs 8, verse 33, heed instruction and be wise and do not neglect it. You can't be wise unless you heed instruction. And what does heed mean?
Hear.
Pardon?
Hear.
Hearing, heeding, though, is the response to hearing. You're actually doing something. Heeding is an action. So, yes, the words are interchangeable, often used that way. But do not neglect the action that you would be appropriate from what you have heard. And so the first action of hearing is doing. We see it also in Proverbs 12 and verse 15. You know, he's talking about the sluggard already. What's the sluggard's idea? No matter that I should, even if somebody told me I ought to get up and get busy and do something. Look at chapter 12, verse 15. The way of the fool is right in his own eyes, but a wise man is he who listens to counsel. Well, before we comment on that, go to chapter 13, verse 10. Speaks to the same kind of mindset. Through insolence comes nothing but strife, but wisdom is with those who receive counsel. In chapter 13 and verse 10, does somebody else have other words other than insolence there? Pardon?
Presumption.
Presumption. What, chapter 13, verse 10. What's the problem? This is the mindset of the know-it-all. Have you ever had anybody that really needed advice and didn't matter who told them or how they told them, even if they told them in the best spirit that it could be said? They're not going to listen. I mean, maybe some of us were that way at some time. You know, you could talk to people for years and years and years, and it's like, come on, folks, dial into this. Yes.
Well, I think the thing of it is that
say it isn't so. Well, I think it. James 1, quick to listen, slow to speak. What's he talking about in James 1 when he says quick to listen? Is he talking about me listening to you necessarily? What's he talking about? Word of God. He's writing to Christians, telling them to remain open to the teaching of the Word of God. Sometimes you just don't need to tell God what to think. You could listen to him, be far better off. And so when I think about insolence, I think about our younger son, to whom Dina used to say things like, well, he's a teenager, you better get out of the house and get rich while you still know everything.
Oh, boy.
You know. You know, that's insolence. When, they got that little age there, you couldn't tell them anything. And, well, yeah, he was it. The know-it-all discounts whatever people say. I mean, you could give them point by point. If you do this, man, you're gonna have it all. Oh, they already got it figured out. It's that presumption, I think your translation said. Yes.
The same way.
Amen.
Children.
Amen.
At a certain age, our boys thought we were dumber than stone. But then they hit a certain age, and all of a sudden, Dad wasn't so dumb. Mom was pretty smart after all. You know, and now they're in their 40s, and boy, we're really smart people. You know, if they would spend that much time thinking about the Bible and maturing in the Bible,
yeah, there's always that time in life where you hear yourself saying things your parents told you 50 years before that. You go, oh, yeah, out of your own mouth now it comes. Well, yes, sir.
But they don't know what they don't know.
Nope.
That's the point.
Because there is at that point just not that innate sense that they're lacking anything. I'm not being ugly about that. But it's just that sense, I can do it myself. I got it all figured out. Well, that's what Solomon's trying to do. He wants to get his boys past this. The actions of the wise, he reveres the Lord. He reveres all things holy. Now, chapter 9 and verse 10 is the other kind of fear. Proverbs 9 and verse 10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. He said, the other kind of fear is the beginning of knowledge. This kind of fear is the beginning of wisdom. I mean, this gets to the point of how are you going to apply what God said? If you don't have this kind of fear of the Lord, does it change anything about the way you live? No. Oh, I know what God said and I know what he means by that, but I'm not going to apply it to my own life. Well, that's somebody that just doesn't fear the Lord. He's talking here about the Hebrews 10:31 kind of fear. It's a terrifying thing to fall into the hands of the living God. What's the Hebrew writer spurring in those saints? He's spurring active repentance. I mean, it does get down to that case. You need to repent or else. And so the readers of the Hebrew letter have got to take that counsel that they receive in that letter. They've got to apply it to their life or they're going to die. They're going to perish. And that's this kind of fear. It does begin first with that reverence for all things holy. The wise man then actively seeks, he asks and searches. Look back at Proverbs 4 and verse 7. He paints the picture that you can almost stumble over knowledge because knowledge is on every street corner, reaching out her hand, crying out. If you want it, knowledge comes, but how do you go from beyond that point? The beginning of wisdom is acquire wisdom. And with all your acquiring, get understanding. So you've got knowledge, you're desiring wisdom. In between the two, you've got to get understanding. Well, how do you get it? He says it very much like a business transaction. You've got to actively acquire it. Chapter 18, verse 15. I mean, it's got to be so valuable to you that you're willing to make the investment. 18 and verse 15. But the mind of the prudent acquires knowledge. And the ear of the wise seeks knowledge. You know, it's got to be so valuable to you, again, that you're willing to make the investment. Again, it's a matter of revering God and reviling the flesh rather than the other way around. When you,
Just to add to this, while we were gone the 6 weeks that we weren't here.
Well, you're making that transition. You began in your life to revere God. You attained some knowledge of the Word. You know what He wants. Well, you move then to the second level of understanding. And the second level is, I understand that this is really good for me. And so you take it and you keep it. I mean, again, as he words it here, it's something you acquire. You actually, in chapter 23 and verse 23, you actually buy it. He paints it like a business transaction. Proverbs 23 and verse 23, buy truth and do not sell it. Get wisdom and instruction and understanding. Buy it. He's talking about making the spiritual investment in it. And don't sell it. It reminds me of some of my distant relatives we all thought were poorer than the church mice. But back in the 50s, they actually inherited it, but they wound up with some blue chip stock. Just left it sitting in the bank all those years. And when he died about 10 years ago, it was worth $1.4 million. He didn't sell it. Keep it. Let it increase. The wise actively invest in acquiring truth. and they hold on to it like blue chip stock. Actively invest in it. What magazines are you subscribing to? Wouldn't it be better to subscribe to Fortify Your Faith or Polishing the Pulpit and all those kind of things? What are you subscribing to? What are you acquiring? Yes. Yep.
You can buy all kinds of tools that will help you work, but if you never use them, they don't do you any good.
Yep.
There has to be action. When you buy that or when you commit, you have to wait and do it. Tawny, in her situation, she knew that partaking of the Lord's Supper is something you do for the first day of the week. She knew that. She understood that. But it's wisdom in doing that. You can know all this stuff, and you can understand it, but if you don't apply it to your life and utilize it in a way, it never becomes wisdom.
Well, the second part of that verse, Proverbs 23 and verse 23, after you buy it, it says, get.
Right. That's
get. I hadn't done the word search on it, and it might be true in Hebrew. I know it's often true in Greek. The word take and get are the same word. It just depends what side of it you're on. If it could very well say, take it. There it is right in front of you. But you got to reach in and take it. Take wisdom and instruction. See, that's, you got to take it. You might read everything that's good, but you go, well, okay, I read that and lay it down. Take wisdom and instruction and understanding. Reminds me of Apollos when he was taught better by Prisca and Aquila. You know, they taught him the way more perfectly. What if he said, I already know it well enough? Didn't take it. Yikes. And fair number of people do that on the matter of salvation. You know, I've been told many times, my family has been this or this denomination for many, many generations, and it's good for them, it's good for me. I don't want to hear it. It's there. Take it. Yes.
And I wanted to ask you, you know, when I would be doing things around June's house and it was Sunday morning and I did the communion and stuff, I had a piece about completing this part of my life. Or I would listen to you or somebody else in the Church of Christ. And I would have a piece to start my day with. And it, you know when you do something right, you get a piece over not knowing that you still got to do it.
And it's not that somebody saw you do it was right. I mean, it's not like, you know, da, da, da. No, you just knew in yourself, in your soul, this is what I was to do. God is pleased with this. And there's that kind of peace. It has to be innately become part of you in the way that it alludes to in Proverbs 7 and verse 4. I mean, if you buy this, if you take from it, then certainly you would want to keep it close to you. Look at Proverbs 7 and verse 4. Say to wisdom, you are my sister, and call understanding your intimate friend. What's it say? What, wisdom, you are my sister. We're like one another. I've taken this wisdom from you, and we've become like it. It's talking about transformation there, isn't it? If the foolish man acquires wisdom and is changed by it, he's transformed by it, you are my sister. We are two of the same kind. Call understanding your intimate friend. It's really the commitment of trust. This is reliance on the dearest companion. And as you would go out in the world, and as Solomon's sons go out in the world, if they would act according to wisdom, what do they know? Wisdom's got your back. Now, somebody can come beat you up from the front and the sides and whatever, but you know what I mean. Wisdom's got your back. Doesn't mean it's going to be easy, but you're covered. What'd you have? Yep. Yeah. And again, that's a matter of first revering God, reviling the flesh. You've got to change your whole value system. You've got to receive sound counsel and really, as Jeff alluded, actually take from it. Hold it close to yourself. And in the sense that wisdom has your back, she's going to take you around the shoulders and say, no, let's go this way. When we're young, do we have that sense? I sure didn't. There'd be a lot of sins I would have avoided if I had that spiritual sense and that really revering God, that I would have, there would have been this sense around my shoulder. You don't want to go that way. Yes, sir.
I think of it as reverence. Wisdom helps you to always do the right thing, or makes it easy to do the right thing.
Yeah. It when you come up against those strong temptations, wisdom can chisel that down for you, make the stumbling block a little smaller, a little easier to step around. But again, you've got to really take it inward. I mean, he's talking about an inward transformation by this acquiring. You got to really take it in, and then she'll get your back. Yeah, that's exactly what she was saying.
Exactly. There's a knowledge that what you're doing is right.
There's a sense of having God's approval on your life. Isn't that what you had, Tony?
Yeah.
There's a sense you had his approval. Mm-hmm. That this is the manner in which you ought to live. This is worthwhile. This is pleasing to God. And you've got that peace. But you had to take all that to yourself, didn't you? You got to take it in. Keep it with you. It had been very easy not to keep the Lord's Supper. It had been easier not to do it. But no. And then you have that peace that Jeff's talking about. And so, somebody, you've got to make the choice to either do wickedness or do wisdom. Look at Proverbs 10 and verse 23. We'll soon have to wind this down for this morning. I'm really enjoying having a class to talk back to me. This is not the televangelist personality that could just on video, but I'm sure I'm enjoying having a class to talk back to me. Look at chapter 10, verse 23. Doing wickedness is like a sport to a fool, and so is wisdom to a man of understanding. I love that picture. Not that I want to be that picture, but folks set on foolishness. What it is like a sport, isn't it? You know, they all get together, whoa, 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 you know, we're going to go out and do something stupid tonight. You know, Solomon earlier talks about those who just hang over the punch bowl because they're just living to get drunk. Well, you know, yeah, it's like a sport. It's a sport to them to get drunk and then to go out and do whatever crosses their mind to do. This word doing here is the word for made or fashioning. What is being wrought by your thoughts, what is being wrought by your actions. There's certainly a result to all that, something that the young folks tend not to understand, that everything has a result. There's a consequence of everything. Well, you must simply choose whether to rot what is wise or to rot what is foolish. In chapter 14 and verse 33, wisdom, did you, yes, go ahead.
Back in 4 and 20,
uh-huh.
It says, my son, be attentive to my words, incline your ears to my saying. Let them not escape from your sight, keep them within your heart.
Same principle, is it? Okay, here are the words made available to him. We can, that'll be a good summary for this class this morning. Perfect summary. Here's the words available to him. There's a godly counselor teaching his sons. They've got a couple of choices. Say, Dad, we know what you did when you were young. I know about you, Dad. I know about you getting drunk with all those women. Yeah, you know, they could do that. Or they can say, well, maybe the old man does know something about what he's talking about. But so he gives them the counsel. What do they got to do? They've got to take it. He's given it. We'll get to it later. Solomon often uses the word receive. And he's talking about receiving it into yourself. They've got to take it into themselves. And it changes lives entirely. Because taking it into yourself, then we're talking about spiritual transformation, aren't we? You aren't what you were. You never will be what you were. So long as you've got that within yourself, and as it said about buying it, you're not going to trade it for anything. You're not going to sell it for anything else. Nobody could make you a deal good enough that you would get rid of that. That's the benefit of first revering all things that are godly, seeking from him understanding, knowing he's going to give it to you, and having that, then applying it in a way that you talked about, Tawny, applying it in a way that really transforms your day, by which you knew you were at peace. That's what he's talking about, isn't it? It's not an easy thing for anyone to really to do when you're set on your own way and you want to do things your own way.
Yeah. Well, such a good example here because how Solomon appears in his life. Same thing applies to Jesus. You know, he's a servant, but he has not lived the right kind of life. He doesn't need to see the cross. But the scriptures give us protection that when I say this,
and in that sense, as I mentioned earlier, wisdom's got your back. This isn't man's notion. This is divine notion. This is the means of living an orderly, worthwhile, and soul-satisfying life. And I guess we better leave it there for this morning. Certainly good to be together again. I've so thoroughly enjoyed having class here together.